Good evening, everyone. Welcome. Welcome, students, faculty, and guests. For those of you who don't know me yet, I'm Sheila Coronel. I am Academic Dean at the Columbia Journalism School. Tonight, we have a very special Delacorte Lecture. It's the first of this current school year. It's special in many respects, and one reason it's special is not only because we have a wonderful guest, but also because this is the first public performance of our new Delacorte professor. The Delacorte Lectures are a tradition here at the J School. They are aimed to let students into what is happening in the magazine industry and in magazine journalism. They're run by the Delacorte Center for Magazine Journalism, which was established here at the Journalism School in 1984 by the magazine publisher George Delacorte, and was supported by his wife Valerie, and with her the New York Community Trust. George Delacorte, if you don't know, founded the Dell publishing empire and was a beloved and rather eccentric philanthropist. He has contributed to some of the architectural wonders you see here on campus, and has also famously donated the Alice in Wonderland statue in Central Park. We are grateful to the Delacortes and to the New York Community Trust for their support of journalism education and our robust magazine program. And now I'd like to introduce one star of our evening, the George T. Delacorte Professor, Keith Gessen. Before joining us here, Keith was the founding editor of N Plus One, an influential New York magazine of culture and politics. If you haven't read N Plus One, you should. Go to the web right now and check it out. Keith is also a contributor to The New Yorker and the London Review of Books. He's editor of three nonfiction books and the translator or co-translator from Russian of a collection of short stories, a book of poems, and a work of oral history. He's the author of a novel and is also writing a new one. I'll now hand over this evening to Keith, and I'll have him introduce our guest for tonight, Nikole Hannah-Jones.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Sheila, for that wonderful introduction. Thank you all for coming. I'm really excited and honored to have Nikole Hannah-Jones of the New York Times Magazine here as our first Delacorte Speaker of the Year. Nikole began her career in newspapers. She worked at the News and Observer in Raleigh-Durham, working on the education beat. Then she moved to Portland, all the way across the country, to work at the Oregonian. There she focused on housing discrimination. Is that right?
For part of the time.
Then she moved to New York to start at ProPublica, where she published a series of incredibly important and moving and highly recommended pieces about the resegregation of America's cities and schools. Not just segregation that anyone who is not blind is aware of, but the actual active and continuing process of the resegregation of our cities and our educational system. About a year ago, she was hired away by the New York Times Magazine, where she has continued her work. There are two reasons that I'm really happy we're having this conversation. One is that I think because this is supposed to be a kind of magazine-focused lecture series, the work that Nikole has been doing is incredibly complex. It's incredibly difficult to get one's arms around it, and I do think the fact that she's been working at a place like ProPublica and working with magazines and now at the New York Times Magazine, those places have given her an opportunity and the space to do this kind of work. It was harder to do in newspapers.
Very hard.
Okay. And the other reason is that, unfortunately, this is an incredibly relevant story right now, one of the most interesting and significant pieces that Nikole has done was about Ferguson in the wake of the Michael Brown shooting, where she went and looked at the school that Michael Brown attended and the history of that school in segregated St. Louis. So it seems to me like resegregation is a story that is kind of underneath and undergirding a lot of the news stories that we are seeing all the time in the United States right now. So please welcome Nikole Hannah-Jones. So just the outline of the evening is I'm going to ask a series of questions, and then about 6:50 we're going to take questions from the audience, and 7:15 we will we'll be done. So, Nikole, I thought we would start just by telling us a little bit about how you got started, why you decided to become a journalist, whether you found journalism school that you attended useful, and how did you get your first job?
Okay. Thank you all for coming out tonight. I'm very happy to be here. I come to this campus quite a bit for various events, so I appreciate you all coming out to listen to me talk. How I became a journalist, I grew up in Iowa, and you know, let's get that out there. There are black people in Iowa. We're mostly related to each other. We certainly know all of, you know, almost everyone, but there were enough of us where we still had a great deal of segregation. We all lived on one side of town, and I started my education in segregated schools. And from an early age, I was just really curious about why the black neighborhood that I lived in looked one way, and across the river, white people seemed to be living a very different life. I was always a skeptical person, even as a child, which often got me in trouble as a child, but it's proven to be a good life skill. And so I was always very curious. I started reading a lot. I was always very enchanted with history, because history helped explain the world to me. And when I was in probably fifth or sixth grade, I started subscribing to Time magazine. I think I wrote my first letter to the editor when I was in middle school. I was a bit of a nerd. I'm okay with that now. And so once I got to high school, I took this black studies class. So I was bused as part of a voluntary desegregation program to white schools starting in the second grade. And I went to a high school that was about 20% black. And I was taking, our high school offered a one semester black studies course. And I took that class, and I was complaining to that teacher, who was my only black male teacher that I think I'd ever had, that our high school paper never wrote about kids like us. And he told me that if I didn't like it, I should join the paper or be quiet. So I took it as a challenge. I joined the paper. I had a column called From the African Perspective, and wrote about black kids and my classmates and what our experiences were like in that school. I won my first journalism award from the Iowa High School Press Association, and was kind of hooked after that. So I picked a college. I only applied to one college, and that was University of Notre Dame, which did not offer journalism. So they offered history, which I also loved. So I majored in history and African American studies, and wasn't really sure if I was going to be a historian or a journalist, and ultimately decided that journalists kind of write history as it's happening, and also journalists write for the masses, and historians write for college students and other historians. And I really wanted to write for, I wanted to write about people like me, or write about it in real time. So I went to journalism school, the school that's the real Carolina blue, not like this Columbia blue. I went to University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and I went to grad school. It was a two-year program, and I loved it. It was great. They had a program for people who wanted to be academics and people like myself who wanted to be professionals but didn't have a journalism background. And so, yeah, that's kind of where I got. How I got where I am.
How did you get your first job?
My first job was at the News and Observer in Raleigh, which is about 30 minutes from Chapel Hill. And I went to a job fair. I was part of the National Association of Black Journalists, and I went to a job fair. My very first job fair, I had done no internships, and I came there with some class papers to Will Sutton, who was a managing editor at the News and Observer at the time. And he very kindly told me, don't ever come to a job fair with class papers again. You need to go get some clips. And so I took his advice, and I came back the next year with clips, and he hired me as an intern. And then when I graduated, he hired me as a reporter there. So my first job was as a public schools reporter in the city of Durham, which was a half black, half white, pretty liberal college town. That's where Duke is. And of course, since I went to Carolina, you know, I hate Duke. And so I started covering public education in a very segregated, high poverty school district right at the height of No Child Left Behind, where we were starting to see the rise of high stakes testing and this belief that if we simply test and hold segregated high poverty schools to a high level of accountability, that suddenly we would get results like white schools. And so this is where I started my journalism career. And so very early on was kind of looking at the results, the very devastating results of school reform that was leaving kids in segregated high poverty schools, which is what really got me interested in the subject.
And were the sort of stories that you were writing, were they about segregation and testing? Is that, were you able to get that into the newspaper? And I mean, what were the kind of hooks that you had to use?
Yeah, I mean, at that time, I had a great editor, and Durham was a town where every story was about race, because it was equally divided, black and white. It had a great deal of power sharing. The city council was half black, half white. The school board was half white, half black. It had a black mayor. And so race was kind of at the forefront of almost of all the politics in that town. And the whole premise of No Child Left Behind was, we're going to count every student, we're going to look at the race of every student, and we're not going to leave black and brown kids behind. So No Child Left Behind was based on race. So it was very easy to pitch stories looking at what were the ramifications of this high stakes testing. And for those of you, there's a lot of young folks in here, so I don't know how much you know about No Child Left Behind, but basically these high poverty segregated schools would not be able to meet the same standards as white schools. And then the schools would be taken over and they would implement all of these reforms that would never work. So it was very easy for me to pitch stories about race, because the entire federal educational bureaucracy was looking at race at that time. Mm-hmm.
So were the stories like, this is not work? I mean, it's June and the test scores are bad. I mean, what was the daily kind of story that you had to, that you could write?
Yeah, so I was spending a lot of time in those schools that were failing and talking to principals, and really also spending time in the heavily white schools, even though it was a majority black district that had very little poverty, and just fundamentally spending time in those classrooms and understanding there was no way you were going to get the same results out of those two schools, that it wasn't a matter of parents not wanting education for their children or kids not trying or necessarily teachers and principals not trying. But when you have a school where 20% of kids are poor and you have a school where 99% of kids are poor, to expect that those kids are going to do the same with the same resources, it's not as if poor schools were getting inordinately more resources. So I started really looking at all of the things that reformers were saying would work, and then asking, why aren't they working? If this reform, and this was like this era of like constant experimentation with black schools. You know, we're going to replace all the staff, we're going to replace the principals, we're going to divide them into small schools, we're going to turn them into specialized schools, we'll try to do a magnet. Every few years, these kids were being experimented on, but the test results were always the same. And that's when I really began to question, can you accomplish educational equity within segregated schools? And you just could not find a school that was able to do it. You could find an elementary school that might turn around for a year or two, and then the scores would slide down. You never found a middle school that was able to turn around, and you never found a high school. And every educator, when they weren't on the record, when they were being honest, would say, what we're being asked to do is impossible when, you know, 9 of 10 kids are coming in here hungry. They're already behind when they're coming into the classroom. A teacher, I mean, if you can imagine as a teacher, when you have 4 kids who are behind in a class of 25, that's one thing. But when you have 21 kids who are behind in a class of 25, and you're being asked to do the same thing with those same resources, you're just not going to get the same results. So the system was really set up to fail, but it was set up to make us feel like, you know, politically, it was okay to say we're just going to hold poor schools accountable, because white parents in this very liberal town, just like white parents in almost every town, didn't really want integration or to do the thing that was necessary to make to give these kids the same education.
And so you've said that at this point you realized that the one thing that would work, integration, is the one thing that people refuse to do.
It was a process. I mean, I don't know that I came to that. I mean, I was a brand new reporter. I was an older reporter. I like to say I was like the oldest intern at the News and Observer. I was like 27 and interning. But I was a new journalist. I was new to education. I was just learning about education coverage. It wasn't necessarily what I sought out to cover as a journalist. I didn't actually know what I wanted to cover. I just knew I wanted to write about race. And so I was learning a lot, but that allowed me, because I didn't already have preconceived notions about what would work and what should work in education, I could just look at all the things they were doing and test them out and say, well, where are the results? Where's the school that's segregated and poor that's actually consistently performing on par with these other schools? And you just couldn't find those results. But I'm also, I mean, I love research. I read a lot. I read a lot of history. I read a lot of sociology. Like every study that comes out in this area, I was reading and just really starting to formulate in my mind this picture where if we could do it, someone would have done it. So if you can't ever show a place that did it, maybe we should stop pretending that this thing is working, that clearly everyone knew wasn't really going to work, but it was the most politically expedient thing.
So I feel like the great story that you've arrived at is the story of resegregation, right? When did you start feeling like that was what you were seeing?
There's two stories. So I grew up in the North, and it's not really resegregation in the North. It's just continuous segregation. And it really wasn't until I moved down South that I experienced living in the South has been the most integrated part of the country in terms of housing and schools for the last 45 years. So the story of resegregation is really a Southern story. And the Northern story is a story of a willful blindness to the continuing ongoing segregation that has always been here at much higher levels than we've seen in the South for the last 50 years. But I think when I really started, I find annoying people who write about race, but always write about it as if these inequalities just float down from the sky, as if they're all a legacy of the past, and you know the only important, you know, the work that we value is who's the racist of the week, who can we show who said something verifiably racist, or we write about studies that say Black people are doing badly here, they're living in these conditions. Which isn't news to anyone, we know that. So I really decided, like, I wanted to understand why. Like, what is causing this? Why are neighborhoods still segregated 50 years after we passed the Fair Housing Act? Why are schools still segregated? Not only segregated, but when you look across every measure, Black and Latino students are getting the least qualified teachers, less likely to get access to academic courses that would get you into an institution like Columbia. Systemically across the country, I wanted to understand why that was. And so that's really when my work began to focus on looking at the particular actions that we've taken in the past, but also that people are taking right now that maintain segregation and racial inequality. And so with schools, resegregation was a way to do that, because if a place had been segregated and then it was integrated, you could go back to that point where it starts resegregating and show that someone had to do something, right? So I started looking at school districts that had been ordered by federal courts to integrate. And when federal courts order you to integrate, they lay out certain things that you as a school district must do. So you have to bus these kids, or you have to have racial balance, or you have to pair a white school and a Black school. And then once a school district is released from that court order, they can do whatever they want. They can create all Black schools if they want to. As long as they never say, we're doing this because we want to discriminate against Black kids, they can do whatever they want. And so it was easy then to go to this point where a school district or school had been integrated, and now it was going backwards, and you could find who did what, who made this decision that resegregated this school, and then ask them about it, and you could trace the point. So when I wrote about Tuscaloosa, I could literally go to the record, look at the public meetings where they're voting to create an all-Black feeder system of schools. I could show the attendance zone map where, like, someone sat down and drew attendance zones that would create an all-segregated school. And you could show them the intent in a way that we don't write about racial discrimination and inequality, where we ever show intent in kind of conscious action. And I think that's what my work has been trying to do, is showing this history, because we also know Americans don't really care about history, and they certainly want to ignore the history of race in this country. So really setting up how we got here, but also saying this is not a legacy, that people right now are making decisions that maintain this, and I'm going to show you how that works. I like to say it's like, was it the red pill or the blue pill on the Matrix? Right, whatever pill it was where you could see all the code, that's what I think of my work as doing, is we live in this kind of, this computer program where we can kind of pretend that all of this is accidental and we just go about our lives and, you know, people all kind of have the same choice because we all on paper have the same rights. But my work is like showing that code behind where all of these inequalities happen and how they happen.
So the Tuscaloosa story is a story that you did for ProPublica, right? What were the sort of stories that you could do for the newspaper, and then what stories could you not do for the newspaper?
Yeah. So, well, one, segregation now is like 10,000 words, so you could never write like anything that long. So what that allowed me to do, though, is tell this story from like. I always say my story started in 1619, which is the year that the first Africans were brought to this country as slaves, or to be slaves. And I say that because I think you just cannot understand anything about racial inequality today without going back and looking at a lot of things that happened in the past. And with a newspaper, you just can't take the time to build that history into the story that I think fundamentally helps you understand. Because when I give talks, everyone always wants to know, like, why? Well, why is it still like that? Why do we do that? And I'm like, because we've been working on this for 400 years, and we've only been working to undo it for maybe 50 and then half-heartedly. So I think understanding how systems over 400 years were created helps us understand how much work it's actually going to take to undo it. And there's just no space for that in a newspaper. You could get maybe two paragraphs. In the Segregation Now piece, two-thirds of that story is history. Only one-third of that story takes place in the present. And if you look at the piece I just did in the New York Times Magazine, I'd say about half of that story is in the past, and half of it is in the present. And I think that's what's so important, is building this case that one then cannot deny of how this inequality is structural and systemic and not accidental, and that it was socially engineered, and so therefore we're gonna have to socially engineer our way out of it.
You said when you won the Best Black Journalist of the Year from the National Association of Black Journalists, you said you were considering quitting journalism sort of toward the end of your time with the Oregonian, is that
yes.
Right? Can you say why?
Of course. I mean, the speech is on the record. So what I have found, and I think a lot of journalists of color find, that is newsrooms want phenotype diversity. They want diverse people who, you know, they want people who look diverse. They don't necessarily want people who think diverse or who think about stories about race in a different way. And when I went to the Oregonian, I made it very clear, I only ever became a journalist because I wanted to write about racial inequality. I like writing about other things sometimes, but what called me to be a journalist was to tell those stories. And when I got to the Oregonian, it just wasn't what they wanted me to do. And so over and over, I would find myself pitching stories and being marginalized for those stories, being told I couldn't write those stories. And at that point, after I went to the Oregonian in 2006, and that was right when the newspaper industry was really in a free fall. There was nowhere for me to go. I had to stick it out there. And after 5 years of just really struggling to tell the stories that I got into journalism to do, I was considering leaving. I was at the point where I felt I wasn't doing what I got into journalism to do anyway, so why was I doing this? Maybe I should think of something else. The problem was I couldn't think of anything else I'd rather be doing, because I do feel like this is my calling. So I was close, but I could never kind of make the leap into doing something else because I couldn't imagine what else I would do with my life.
And how did you happen? How did you end up at ProPublica? How'd that happen?
I was rescued. So Steve Engelberg, who was the founder of ProPublica, was the managing editor at the Oregonian when I was there, and I worked under him there. And so he ended up bringing me on to ProPublica, really, really right at the point where I probably would have left journalism within the next 6 months. At that point, so I always say, I mean, I said this at my speech. at the National Association of Black Journalists that he saved my life in that way, because this is my calling, and if he wouldn't have taken me out of that situation, and when he brought me to ProPublica, I made very clear, if I can't write these stories, don't hire me, because I don't want to go to another place where I can't do that, and he gave me free rein. Now I'm here.
You've said that you've seen a lot of journalists who were in a similar position who didn't get rescued. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I could go down the list of black and brown journalists who have left news because they became very disillusioned with not being able to write the stories that they got into journalism to write. I think newsrooms can be very unfriendly to people who don't just look diverse, but actually want to tell those stories in a very particular way. One of the things that I heard was like, you want to write about black people too much. And I remember having this conversation with the editor at the Oregonian, like, have you ever had that conversation with a white journalist? Have you ever told a white journalist they're writing about white people too much? I mean, you can't even imagine that conversation happening, though it should absolutely happen. And when I was told that, I actually went back through our old story system and I printed out every story I'd ever written since I'd been there. And then I put on a stack every story that even had a black person in it, even if I didn't identify the person as black, if I just knew the person was black. And it was 10% of my stories, literally 10%. And I took those two stacks into that office and I was like, what is it about you and me that makes you think that me writing 10% of my stories about black people is too much? It wasn't really a good answer because in their head, they overestimated how many stories they thought I was writing about race. And what I was always told was, you know, there's not that many black people here. You're not writing to our audience. But you will never get that audience if you're not telling those stories. And it's also just not an accurate reflection of our society and our communities that we're supposed to be covering.
And yet,
like the snaps.
yesterday during the debate, some people were snapping, but nobody could hear them. So at the Oregonian, though, I mean, I've read some of the pieces that you did about housing discrimination, and those seemed to feed directly into the big piece that you then did about the Fair Housing Act, right? So it does seem like you were building a kind of, I mean, and really, and also with your education work, I mean, What was it like to come to a position where you were now allowed to write at length with, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 years of really solid kind of day-to-day reporting on it? That must have been nice.
Yeah, I mean, it was amazing and scary because, you know, when you're writing something every week or every 2 weeks, if a couple, you know, not that many people read it, it's not a big deal. When you spend 1 year on something, it better be good. So there's a lot of pressure, but no, it was an amazing feeling to finally go from where I always felt I could do bigger work. I wanted to do bigger work. I was always interested in doing more investigative work, but as we know, a lot of times women and journalists of color are not seen and groomed to be on projects teams and to be able to do kind of larger work. So to have someone who trusted that I could do that and just given the freedom to do it was the most amazing experience in the world. And I think that that's part of the reason why, I mean, I recently founded an organization to help more journalists of color become investigative reporters, because I feel like it's the most important work that we can do in our democracy is holding power accountable for how it treats our most vulnerable citizens. But it's even wider than standard newsrooms. So I think what it allowed me to do and what I will always love about ProPublica was there was not really a template for the type of writing that I was trying to do, not in investigative reporting anyway, and they just trusted me to do it and just let me do my thing. And if there's like anything that I would say to editors, like, let journalists do their thing and you'll be amazing what they're able to produce, but I think you just don't see that enough.
How would you describe the sort of work that you did there? When you say there wasn't a
Long.
Template.
Lots of words.
Excellent. But, I mean, when you say there wasn't a template, what do you mean?
I think, again, it my work isn't probably like traditional investigative reporting in that way. I spent a lot of time building this historical case. I think if you look at my more recent work, it definitely has a point of view. I'm not trying to go down the middle and just say I'm just laying out a dispassionate viewing of the facts. I'm making an argument at this point. And I think that that's not the usual way that this is done. But they gave me the freedom to do that. And I think, one, because the reporting is sound. So even though I'm coming clearly from a point of view that segregation is wrong and we should do something about it, the reporting is very sound. But also, I to give that much space to like things that, when I was writing about school segregation, a lot of people were dead that I was writing about. And typically when you're doing investigations, you're writing about like people who are doing things only now. And like ProPublica really wants to have impact. So they want you to do a story where like someone's gonna lose their job or some law's gonna get changed. Well, I'm writing about school segregation or housing segregation, fully expecting that when this publishes, nothing will change. Ever. And I still don't think it really will. And so, but they let me do that, not expecting that I'm going to get some law passed or, there's going to be this huge shift in our society because of the work. So to let a reporter spend a year on an investigation that will likely not produce any result except that people may be outraged is pretty amazing thing. But really making, I see myself as like, I'm making a record and I'm hoping forcing us to confront things that we don't want to confront, whether we're going to fix them or not. I'm always thinking about the people trapped in these communities, what they could be if we actually treated them as full citizens. I'm always thinking about the children trapped in these classrooms who, as Nedra Martin in my This American Life piece said, like her daughter could be the doctor who saves your child's life one day, and we're squandering all of these children. That's what I'm always thinking about, even if I don't think my writing is going to change the situation for them. I'm just not going to let us pretend they're not there.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the powerful things about your work is I think a lot of Americans feel like, well, if we just give it kind of 300 years, this stuff will kind of work itself out. But these kids don't have 300 years. Well, they're in school for 10 years. So you come to ProPublica with this background, doing a lot of reporting, and you have these two big stories, school segregation and housing segregation, which obviously are connected. How do you go about choosing how to tackle these giant subjects? How do you go about choosing?
Yeah, so I mean, the good thing is there was one great thing that came out of my very hard time at the Oregonian, and that was that it was a narrative paper, and that's ultimately why I went there, was it believed in narrative journalism, and I believed in narrative journalism because I understand you can do these like fabulous investigations, and if they're dry, no one's going to read them. If you don't connect with people on a human level, it doesn't matter that you found all of this wrongdoing. So that's always been my instinct, is to tell these hard stories through compelling narrative. So I'm always at the beginning thinking about what is the narrative, what is the narrative device or structure that can drive this story that's probably really hard to read. So when I did Segregation Now on Tuscaloosa, I mean, one, it was part of the narrowing process about where I would tell that story had to do with the narrative. Tuscaloosa is where George Wallace stands in the schoolhouse door. It's Alabama, which is like the cradle of the Confederacy, but also the cradle of the Civil Rights Movement. And so I'm thinking about that when I'm kind of choosing where I'm going to go. And I'm investigating like what happened, how did the resegregation happen here, and who are the characters, and can I tell this story in a way? So what made it interesting there was that the black elite worked with the white elite to resegregate the schools.
So in case anybody hasn't read the article.
Wait, you mean all y'all have not read the article?
I think they have, but for the TV audience at home, this is Tuscaloosa is a place that had a big integrated high school, Central High School, right?
Right.
That was integrated in the course of the late 70s and 80s, became a kind of powerhouse in football and debate.
Right.
And then they resegregated.
Right. So basically, as most people don't know, Brown v. Board happened, and then everyone didn't hold hands and have a kumbaya moment, and we just all integrated. There was a lot of foot dragging, and school districts had to be brought to court. So real integration didn't come to Tuscaloosa until about 1988, which is actually fairly common. And what the judge ended up doing, there was a black high school and a white high school and a black middle school and a white middle school, and he just merged those schools. So if you were a middle school student in Tuscaloosa, you all went to the same school and everyone went to the same high school. And they created really this just blockbuster powerhouse high school. It was like the dream of integration. The imperfect dream of integration, but it was still the dream of integration. And then immediately, but the district was also experiencing a lot of white flight. And so as soon as they were released from the court order, they destroyed that integrated high school and created three high schools and an entire feeder system of kindergarten through 12th grade of all black high poverty schools. So that was just a fascinating story narratively, right? Because you have this place that was forced to integrate 30 years after Brown v. Board, and then creates this amazing high school that's like kicking everybody's butts. I was gonna say the A word, but I forgot, it's on C-SPAN. So like, it was like beating sports teams all across the country. It was producing all these national merit scholarships, and even that wasn't enough to like hold integration together. And so you could go and you could look at this place and what they did to create these all black schools, but also that the black elite was part of that. So that was all part of the calculation and like why I chose to tell the story of resegregation from Tuscaloosa. And before I even went down there, I knew I also wanted to tell it through three generations of one family. I knew that. I hoped I would find the family to tell it through, but I understood that this so much of this history is going to take place in the past, and if I wanted people to care about it, I needed to have a human face that would connect them from the past to the present. And luckily, I found the perfect family, pretty early on.
But you talked to some other families who were less perfect.
Yeah. I mean, the main character in the Segregation Now story is a young lady named Delisha who is at the all-black high school, and she's just everything. She's class president. She's a state track champion on the mayor's youth council. Like, everything that we tell kids that they should be if they want to be successful, she was, but she was at a segregated high school that was failing her in terms of her education. But what made the family perfect was I wanted a grandparent who had gone through segregated schools after Brown to show how desegregation didn't come to this country after Brown, and then whose parent had gone to the integrated high school in that town as a result of the court order, and now found the grandchild back in segregated schools that looked just like the schools that the grandparents had attended. And that's what I was really looking for, and that's what I found in that family.
But a school like Central High School, are there a lot of schools like that were integrated and then became unintegrated?
So the South is experiencing, a wave of resegregation because the only thing that was holding it back were these federal court orders for the most part. We never wanted integration in this country, and I think that's a myth we tell ourselves, is that we wanted it and we tried really hard and it failed. We failed because we didn't really want it. And there was this brief period of time where the federal government was forcing it, and where it forced it, many times it did work. But as soon as we started releasing those courts, because a lot of these court orders were 40 or 50 years old, and the Supreme Court had made it increasingly easy for districts to be released from their court orders. And once they were released, we went back to kind of our natural state of things, which is to immediately do things to resegregate. So the peak of integration in this country was 1988, which was when I was in middle school. And now black students are as segregated as they were in 1972. And the typical experience of a black student in this country is to attend a segregated high poverty school. The typical experience for a white student is to attend a white segregated low poverty school.
And in reporting the Tuscaloosa story about Central High, as you mentioned, the resegregation was a kind of agreed to by some of the black leaders in the community because they were afraid that they wouldn't be able to attract business if they didn't have a high quality kind of majority white school, basically.
Right.
When did you find that out? Was that early in the reporting, or were you surprised to find that out? And did you find it to be? Was your initial reaction like, oh, this is not actually a very good case, or were you excited to learn that, or what was your reaction to it?
Yeah, I think it's great for the narrative. I think it gives texture and nuance, and I think when you look at all these cases, there's all these compromises that have happened. I mean, school desegregation was very hard on black communities. It was always the black schools that were shut down, the black teachers and the black principals who were fired. It was black kids who typically were getting on long bus rides outside of their communities to go into white schools. And for many of the black civil rights leaders who had pushed for desegregation, they felt that the cost had been too high for black children, and that they were chasing white children all across the city, and white children just kept fleeing them. So what happened in Tuscaloosa is it goes from a majority white school district to a majority black school district. And the fear was, if you didn't set aside a pocket of mostly white schools, the entire school district would turn black. And then you couldn't have any integration because you would have no white kids left in the district. But also, then every time you try to pass a tax in a majority white town, because the city of Tuscaloosa was still majority white, if you have a majority white town and an entirely black school system and you try to pass a tax for schools, white parents aren't going to vote for that because their kids aren't in the schools. Businesses aren't going to support it because their employees that they care about don't have kids in the schools. So there was this calculations that communities were having to make that we will tolerate some level of segregation for our poorest, most vulnerable black kids in order to keep white kids in the district. And I think that was an important story to tell, because that's a story that has happened in communities all across the country. You see it in New York City. Middle-class black kids are typically not going. I mean, they're the kids who are in schools with white kids. It's the poorest, most vulnerable kids who are being segregated. So I thought that was important because it talks about kind of the failures of the civil rights movement. The black elite at that point thought that they were going to broker. They understood that a judge was going to release that district from the court order. And as soon as it did, the district could do what it wanted to anyway. So they figured if they tried to negotiate some terms, at least they could get something out of it for the black community, which they thought would be economic development. Unfortunately, didn't work out that way. Oh, didn't. They didn't get the economic development, so they made the decision and still didn't get it. But a lot of people in that community had believed that the black elite had sold them out, but they just could never prove it. And I was able to finally get on the record the black judge in the town who basically signed the deal to admit that he did it.
One of the difficulties of the stories that you're telling is the fact that white people have gotten much better at not being explicit. I mean, in the presidential campaign, they've gotten worse at it, but they've gotten better at not being such explicit racists, right? So you don't often have the smoking gun of somebody, you know, saying the N-word, for example, right? So you've adopted a kind of, I've heard you describe it, and it's almost like the legal definition, right, of what segregation now is, rather than a kind of narrative definition, right? Could you say about that?
Yeah. So I mean, what made, of course, during the civil rights movement, we were dealing with what's called de jure segregation, which is segregation by law. What we're mostly talking about today is called de facto segregation. But I actually think de facto segregation is a fallacy. De facto segregation is a term that was adopted by the North to resist having to come under Brown v. Board. And so de facto means that it's segregation by fact, but we don't really know who caused it. No one's necessarily responsible. We can't say there was a law that forced it or particularly government officials that mandated it. And so that was how most segregation outside of the South, where it was written into the laws, was categorized. But I would argue, and I think my work, which is why I never actually say de facto or de jure, I just call it segregation, is that most of the segregation we see today is still de jure, in that it is still a result of official policy. It's still the result of official actors. When the school officials in the city of Tuscaloosa made the decision to draw an attendance zone that creates 13 years of entirely black high poverty schools, I don't know how you call that anything but intentional segregation. And so one of the things that I talk about a lot with journalists is stop getting so caught up in what you can prove someone was thinking. Look at their actions and look at whether or not they knew what the results of those actions would be. So one of the things I say is when you think about it, when ExxonMobil has a spill in the Gulf, and we would never say, you know, it's like, we don't care if the head of Exxon Mobil like hates ducks or not, right? Like, we don't. It doesn't matter to us like how he feels about the environment, whether he likes, you know, seagulls or whatever. We only care that like there were certain things that you should have done and you didn't do it, and that this was a foreseeable result of that. But when it comes to race, suddenly like the only thing that matters is whether we can prove that someone like hated black people. You could take every possible action, and if we can't prove that you hated black people when you were doing it, then suddenly we don't feel like we can report on those actions in the way that we need to. And my work is saying, like, I don't care. I can show that you made a decision that you knew would be harmful and you did it anyway. And I want to know why that is. And I think that's the way that we need to be thinking about reporting on race. I mean, legal discrimination has been outlawed in this country for 50 years. People know how not to do that and write things on paper. But it's not an accident that in every facet of American life, we're still seeing black Americans being disadvantaged. That's not accidental or incidental. And I think that's how we need to be writing about these issues.
So I'm going to ask one more question, but if people want to start coming up to the microphone to ask their own questions, they should start doing that now. A few months ago, you had a piece in the New York Times Magazine where you described your decision to send your daughter to a high-poverty, segregated school. Did you do that as a journalist?
Did I make the decision as a journalist?
Yeah.
No.
But it was based on your experience of reporting on this topic for a decade and more.
Yeah, I mean, it's one thing to write about public schools when you don't have kids. And it's a very different thing to like write about public schools when you actually now have to make the decision about your own child. So I guess I'd reframe the question. I made the decision as a mom. I made the decision as a human being who actually thinks what we're doing to kids is wrong, and understanding that by pretending it's only systemic, it allows us to get off the hook about our individual decisions. But clearly, all my years of reporting informed my decision to enroll my daughter in that school. I remember very early on as a brand new public schools reporter in Durham, hearing all the excuses that liberal parents would give about why they would not put their kids in a school with poor black kids. I remember one of my earlier stories was about Durham tried to use magnet schools to integrate certain schools in poor neighborhoods. And they did a survey because like a lot of school districts, they were always very hyper-concerned about what white parents wanted because those were the parents they had to keep in the district. Poor black parents were gonna be there. They didn't have anywhere else to go. So they did the survey of parents and they're asking, what do you want in your schools? And every single thing that those parents said they wanted existed in these magnet schools in the inner city that couldn't get any white kids. And I just remember, I wrote a story about that. And I just remember how, like, thinking, all these parents, like, they think they're good people, they are good people, they'd say none of their decisions are ever about race, but they're willing to tolerate this inequality. And then throughout the years of my reporting, steadily meeting other journalists who are cataloging racial inequality, but when you ask where they lived or where they sent their own children to school, they weren't living what they were writing. And I just couldn't fathom doing that. So I like to say I'm not judging other people. It probably doesn't ring true. I probably am judging. but for me, it was just never a choice. Like it's hard to actually say it as a parent that I literally don't think my daughter deserves more than other kids, but I really don't think that she does. I didn't test her for talented and gifted. I think she's smart. I don't think she's brilliant. I don't think it matters. And I think as parents, like we've gotten to this like consumer culture around this thing that we say we believe is the great equalizer, right? This thing that we say is like this important institution where it doesn't matter where you came from, you all come in here and come out with the same thing. But then we've turned it into, you know, this thing that we have to vie for and we have to use our best privilege for, and I need to secure every advantage for my child. And I just fundamentally don't believe in that. Also knowing like, I have choice, and anything my child doesn't get in that school, I can give her. But that's not true for all the other kids in my daughter's classroom who are living in public housing with parents who are doing the best they can and have no resources whatsoever. So I think it's the inequality is systemic, but every choice that we make is holding up that system, and there's just no way I could do that. But I also understand, and I think that's what the New York Times piece really tries to grapple with, is that that is a hard decision for parents to make, and I understand that too, because when you have so much inequality, to ask a parent to subject their child to that, to the very schools that I say are not educating kids, it's a big ask.
And how's school so far?
She's great. My daughter's a sassy little child who's doing great. She's doing great, but that's the thing. Like, for those of us who can give our kids everything, our kids will do great in any environment. And I think that's why we need to stop being so selfish about it. Me being in her school changes the entire dynamic of that school. Them knowing that there's a New York Times reporter who's a parent at that school changes the entire dynamic of that school, right? And we know this, though, because, I mean, this is what I say in my piece. Like, integration is about power. It's about access to power and who has it and who doesn't. And when you have an entire school with every parent lives in a housing project, we know that officials don't care what those parents need. We know that there's nothing that those parents can do that are going to get, like at PS8, the white wealthy school, that are going to get 10 elected state, you know, officials to come to weekly meetings about 50 kids not getting their first choice for kindergarten. That's really what integration is about, and I think everyone knows that. I think white parents know that, black parents know that, and that's why people try to protect their power. But I have my power whether my daughter's in that school or not, but I can share that power if I'm in that school with those kids.
Great, thank you. All right, let's take some
questions. I'll try to keep my answers shorter, y'all, sorry.
I thought that was great. Thank you, please.
Hi, how are you? can you hear me? I think you can. Can you hear me? Well, I was first introduced to your work when you did the problem that we all live with and for this American life, and I felt like, can you talk a little bit about, like, when you're dealing with the education beat, like, how do you generate access to the families in these neighborhoods, I mean, in these communities that are somewhat closed off, in a sense, and how do you profile, like, how do you figure out which is the right person to create that narrative arc within your pieces?
So the families are easy. It's getting access to the schools that can be really hard. I find that families always want to talk because they know that they're being screwed. They know that their kids are not getting the education that they deserve. And so I never have a hard time with the families. It can be really hard to get into the schools. But what I've also found is that a lot of times the teachers and the principals in those schools also know that they're being set up to fail, and that you can get access by talking to people who know them to get them to meet with you and getting access into the schools that way. In terms of the narrative, this is something that I struggle with a lot, actually, because I'm always trying to balance two things. I want to pick a kid who is fairly representative, but I'm also always understanding who I'm writing to, and that I need to pick a kid that people actually think deserve an education. And I'm very troubled by that. Like, I struggle with that because I think, you know, the kid who is a C student, who's come to school with lots of issues, clearly deserves an education too. But I need to find the kid that someone will really be outraged about, and they're just never outraged about the C black student. They are outraged about Delisha, who is making all A's, who's like doing everything that she could possibly do and is being screwed. And so I'm working on that because I actually have a lot of inner turmoil about that and about not being able to write about the typical kid in these schools because I need white people to be outraged, so they'll do something. So typically when I'm looking for a student, I'm looking for, one, someone who can articulate what's happening so that when I'm interviewing them, that they've given some thought to their circumstance, which a lot of us don't. I mean, When I was in school, I remember when I was in Tuscaloosa, in the black high school, it had no AP classes, and the white high school, or the most heavily white high school, had like 20. And the school board member, when confronted by a student, said, well, you should have asked for this. You should have asked for physics. And I'm thinking, like, what high school kid looks at your course catalog and is like, there's not classes here that I want to take. I'm going to ask them to give them to me. Like, you pick from the classes that you're given. So I think a lot of times kids don't, you only know what you've seen. And so you don't even necessarily know you're getting a bad education. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. But I think most kids don't know. A lot of times kids in poor schools, parents have not received a good education. So they also don't know what good instruction looks like. So I'm looking for a kid or a family who has some sense that they're not getting what they're supposed to get so that we can talk about that, so that I'm not just speaking for them, but they're able to speak for themselves. So that's kind of what I'm looking for, someone who has, you know, like all of us, we want someone who has a compelling narrative, someone who can articulate that narrative, someone who can evoke some kind of emotion in the reader or the listener. And you do that by talking to a lot of people and usually going with your gut, like who you've connected with, and spending a lot of time with them.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I said I was going to answer shorter, and that certainly was not shorter.
Hi, my name is Tori, and I, like you, really value the sort of historical background that leads to these greater systemic problems, and I struggle a lot in my own figuring out of journalism how you bring that historical perspective to bear on these problems, because I think sometimes in other reporting it can seem sort of piecemeal. We're looking at problems very much decontextualized, and I think your work has resonated with so many people because it does have that, but not all of us are going to be able to have the ability to have someone like ProPublica scoop us up and give us that opportunity. So how would you recommend that people who are interested in reporting on these types of issues are able to incorporate that sort of historical and systemic understanding into the work in a compelling way that may have to be a lot shorter?
Yeah, so I mean, I was a beat reporter for most of my career, so I didn't always have the luxury of a lot of space and a lot of time. I mean, the first thing I would say is, like, you actually have to know the history yourself if you're going to write about it. And I think a lot of times journalists are not spending the time to figure out what's the history of this place. I can't even tell you when I talk how many education reporters, I'm like, have you ever read Brown v. Board of Education? Have you ever read any of the case law around school desegregation? Have you read the Civil Rights Act? Have you read the Fair Housing Act? So a lot of times, you're not going to write about it if you don't know. I mean, when Baltimore was on fire, the first thing I'm thinking about is Thomas v. HUD, which was this fair housing lawsuit where you know, the city of Baltimore, the county of Baltimore, and the federal government were all sued for intentionally segregating black folks in the inner city. That gives you, like, mad context for, like, why Baltimore is on fire. But if you don't know that history, you're never putting that in the story. So it's not even necessary that you have to spend 3,000 words on the history. You have to have some understanding of the history. And if you even put three paragraphs of that history in your story, you've given your readers a lot more context to understand what's happening there than if you haven't. So to me, the biggest problem is not time and space. It's lack of curiosity amongst reporters to really figure out why a place is like it is. And this is why I always say, you know, as a black reporter, people look at me and they think they know what my biases are. They think they know the particular framework from which I'm writing a story. But we don't look at white reporters and have that same assumption. You look at the way that reporters cover education, most white reporters are coming from segregated white public or private schools that were very high functioning. And so it can be impossible to imagine the systemic reasons why these other schools are failing when that's your framework. So I think that is the biggest problem, is the lack of curiosity about this history, the lack of trying to really go out and get that context and understand that context. And if you have that, you don't need a lot of space to put it in. That's also going to inform how you report all the stories, because we're all building a body of work. It's not ever one story. Right? If you're covering a beat, you're writing multiple stories around this issue, and having that context is going to inform what stories you tell and how you tell them and what your subsequent stories are.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So first off, thank you so much for your amazing talk. Thank you for being so honest with us as well. My question
I always
for
fear
you,
it's going to get me in trouble, but.
I love it. My question for you is, in a lot of top-tier universities and Ivy Leagues, you see a lack of Black students from poorer neighborhoods, especially of lower class. And I'm just curious, and then you see more Black students from like higher middle class type homes. Have you done any research on why this is? And do you believe that universities look into family backgrounds when they're picking Black applicants to accept into their schools?
I mean, I have lots of thoughts. I mean, I actually worked in college admissions right out of college, and I can tell you, college admissions officers know the high schools, right? They know which high schools are segregated. They know which high schools have a good reputation. So you can have a 4.0 from Central High School, or you can have a 4.0 from Northridge High School in Tuscaloosa, and guidance admissions counselors know the difference between what that 4.0 means at one school and at another. But I also think there's just, you know, when I went to Notre Dame, there was a small Black population, but the Black population there was very well off. And it was like, it was a struggle to be both Black and working class at an institution like that. I think universities don't want to put in the work to recruit. I think they don't want to put in the work to like actually help those students once they get there. And when you look at the numbers on this, it's not just that they are not recruiting a lot of low-income Black students. They're not recruiting a lot of Black American students, right?
That's very true.
So a lot of those Black numbers are actually Black students who are coming either second generation or first generation American from Caribbean or from Africa. So I think anti-Black racism and particularly anti-Black American racism is a big part of how hard it is for Black American students and low-income Black students to get into institutions like this.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi. Thank you for being here today. I have a question about advocacy journalism. You mentioned that you now go into your stories knowing that you have a perspective and that's okay. And of course, your sound reporting backs it up. But I'm wondering if you ever worry that being seen as an advocate for an issue will negatively affect the way that readers view your work and how you deal with that.
So I've been very open almost all of my career that I don't believe in unbiased journalism. It doesn't exist. All reporters have a perspective on what they're writing. It's whether they're hiding it or not. I never pretend to be unbiased. What I do say is my work will be accurate and my work will be fair. And that is what I think readers should expect from any of us. I mean, when you think of the nature of investigative reporting, to me, by what it is advocacy reporting. Because we're saying the government is doing this and it shouldn't be, right? Or we're saying this corporation is taking advantage of, you know, these Americans and it shouldn't be, and we're writing this because we want it to be fixed. So when you look at the very mission of newspapers, when I was at the Oregonian, like, the mission was to speak for the powerless. That's taking a position, because we certainly could have the mission that we're going to speak for the powerful or that we're going to not speak for anyone. But that's not the role that we play. So to me, I think that when you know kind of where I stand to an extent, you can judge my work better, because I'm not pretending to be unbiased. So you can judge what it is that I'm writing. Am I writing something that's fair? And I think what I worry about is what all good journalists worry about, is that I'm going to make a mistake. I worry about being accurate. And I worry about treating people fairly. And I don't worry for one second about whether people think I'm biased or not. Because if people want to know if I'm biased, that I think segregating kids in schools without resources is a problem, I'm actually fine with that.
Thanks so much.
Hello, I very much enjoyed your recent piece on This American Life. Just kind of wondering how changing medium from print to something which is broadcast affects how you kind of approach people you're working with, particularly people who are more vulnerable than others, whether it makes a difference at all, and how it kind of contributes to texturing a different final output.
Yeah, I actually found, for that particular angle, I found it liberating to do radio, because people are speaking for themselves so much more, right? Like when when you're writing with magazine, you can write much, you can give people a lot more space to speak. But in newspapers, you know, it's like one sentence, he said one sentence. But for radio, most of the stories, people are telling it in their own words, and you're getting to hear them. You're giving them a lot of space to tell their own stories. And I found that to be completely liberating. That's why I'm not a radio reporter, but I always heard, I did a print version of that story first, but I always heard it as a radio piece because I just thought the power of one, clearly hearing like that mob in the gym, the high school gymnasium. There's no way I could have conveyed that in print the way that it is to hear it. But also I just, when I interviewed Maria, when I interviewed Nidra, I just felt like people needed to hear their voices and hear them telling their own stories. So I found that to be very powerful. I think what's hard about it is it becomes much more about the storytelling. So I like to, have lots of facts and lots of like data points, and you have to wipe out a lot of that in radio. You know, no one's trying to hear like all the statistics on like school segregation or all the percentages of how many teachers are qualified and all of that. So a lot of the really like investigative part, I think, has to get polished out in a story, and that can be a little hard. But overall, I think in terms of like giving people agency, radio was actually a really great way to do that.
Hi. Do you think that there's a place for white people to write about race and segregation, even if we might arguably be displacing people of color?
Yeah. I mean, the story of race and segregation is not a black story. Right?
No, of course not.
Be quiet, Jelani. Right? I mean, it's not, right? I mean, I think...
But when I've listened to the Black Lives Matter people speak a lot of them have said that this is the time for white people to stand aside and be in, like, the listening place, because typically, like, when you look back in time, like, a lot of white people have written, had these, like, dominant positions in, like, forums for being able to communicate. But do you think it's more important for us to step aside and allow people of color to communicate their stories?
No, I mean, I think that journalists of color should be writing about race if they want to, and I think white people should certainly be writing about race. I think the problem is white people often think writing about race is writing about like black or brown folks, but white people are living in segregated communities. White people are going to segregated schools. White people are often the ones in power who are maintaining the segregation or maintaining the racial inequality. So certainly you guys should be writing about not just race, like going and writing about like how black people are suffering, but writing about how power is working and what that power looks like. So, and as journalists, we're always writing about, I don't know how journalists do their job without writing about all kinds of different types of people and all kinds of different types of issues. It's not displacing someone. I think it's doing your job. One of the things that I say all the time is that there's not really a beat you can cover in this country where you shouldn't be writing about race. Race is on every single beat. If you're writing about banking, if you're writing about schools, if you're writing about policing, if you're writing about business, if you're writing about housing, like there's nothing that race doesn't touch in this country. So if you're actually a journalist doing your job, you should be writing about race no matter what color you are and what beat you're covering.
Even if we're limited by the range of our experience?
We're all limited by the range of our experience. I mean, when I'm working on a story on environmental justice right now, I don't know anything about the EPA. I don't know anything about the laws regulating the environment and toxins. This is the nature of journalism, is to have to learn about things that we don't know about and then try to synthesize them for mass consumption. So I think that we need to get out of this mind state that race is somehow different. You study it. I'm not good at writing about race because I'm black. I'm good at writing about race because I have studied the hell out of it, right? I mean, that's what makes me good. And believe me, there's a lot of black writers who I don't think are very good at writing about race. Well, I could name some. No, I'm playing. I'm not going to name them. I'm just kidding. I'm not going to do that. But I think, like, I have developed an expertise in this subject, and that is why I'm good at it. It's not just because inherently when I wake up in the morning, I'm just a great race writer. So I think all of us, if this is something that we want to do, you get an expertise in it, and you'll do good work.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Two more. Two more?
Sure.
Okay.
You talk in the New York Times piece about the way New York City is kind of dealing with integration as a like voluntary measure, and kind of making the argument that it benefits white families in addition to black and Latino families. I'm wondering if you think that argument is actually ever gonna, I know in New York right now it's kind of covering up real action from taking place. I'm wondering if you've seen in your research or you think that that argument's ever gonna hold sway, or it's just a way to keep kicking the can down the road.
What argument?
That it's in the interest of white families and white students to have integrated schools too.
I think that one, there's two, it's two different things, right? I mean, integration for black and Latino students is about equality and it's about equity, and integration for white students is not. So fundamentally, you're making two different arguments. But I think that the argument that I would make is, when you had a country that was 80% white, it's one thing to stop 20% of your population from getting an education and being able to be, you know, citizens who can play a role in our society. It's another thing to have 50% of your population who's undereducated and unable to like pay your Social Security and to work living wage jobs. So in that way, I think fundamentally as our country changes, I don't think that makes us better on race. I mean, we could look at any country that has already gone minority white, or any city in this country that's already gone minority white, and know that that doesn't necessarily fundamentally change power. But I think as a country, when you are having half of your public school students are black and Latino, if you're gonna choose not to educate them, it is going to harm you, right? Like, there is actually going to be a harm to white students. I don't think we've realized that yet, but I think that is where we're coming to. So I mean, I'm not an optimistic person. Anybody who reads my work knows that I don't have a lot of optimism about race. I think if you study history, you don't have a lot of reason to have optimism. But I think that what I do know is we cannot continue to go as we are, that you cannot have half of your population uneducated and unable to take these important jobs and do this important work. And we didn't have that before. So maybe, but probably not.
Thanks.
Hi, Nicole.
Hey, girl.
So, we know each other, sorry.
she came all the way from London just to see me tonight. Just playing. No, she didn't.
Tally-ho. But anyway, so my question is about the Ida B. Wells Society, your organization for journalists of color, trying to encourage them to be more active in investigative journalism. Mother Jones did an article about a month ago about how it's really hard for them to continue to encourage this passion in journalists to do investigative journalism because of funding. Is your organization going to work in concert in trying to get organizations to continue to push investigative journalism, especially when pieces like yours are doing so well, not just in education, but other people who are doing investigative pieces that really change the conversation in society?
Yeah, I mean, I think the funding argument when it comes to diversity is a red herring. I think that clearly newsrooms are struggling in general, and investigative reporting is very expensive. I mean, to pay someone's salary to produce one thing a year is very expensive. But I don't think that that is the reason why we have a diversity problem in investigative reporting. So what we're trying to push is that there are people who are qualified, and we need to find a way to hire them. So I don't think the funding is the issue. What you find a lot of times is a lot of these organizations will do fellowships, and that is how they are hiring journalists of color. But I think that's just a backdoor way. I think you should just find talent and hire them, and I think that's what our organization is going to be pushing for. But also understanding that if journalism overall is disproportionately white, investigative reporting is even whiter, and we're not being given the opportunities or the guidance or the training or the mentorship to do this type of work. And so that's one thing that we're going to work on. And once we've trained a cohort of journalists, then when a newsroom has an opening, it will be much more difficult to say we can't find a qualified person, because I can tell you that person's qualified because I have trained them. So that's what we're trying to do with the society.
Excellent. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, that's it. Thank you all for coming, and thank you, Nikole.